guys, I'm the Drink Pro. Today we're drinking Belle Meade Cask Strength Reserve. Hey everybody, the Drink Pro here. Thanks again for tuning in. I really am excited about doing this review. Belle Meade Cask Strength Reserve Whiskey. This is really hard to find where I'm living here in Indiana, but some places have good access to this. I actually picked this bottle up when I was in a conference in Tennessee, but in Nashville to be specific. I really enjoy some of the stuff that's coming out of Belle Meade. They recently did a really big release of the Belle Meade Honey, which was finished in honey barrels, and they really are trying to explore the space of whiskey. This particular edition is a cask strength version that's done in batches. Now, it's not specifically barrels. It's not a single barrel product, but it's a batch product. And so they're essentially doing small combinations of barrels to put together into individual batches. So this batch number is 19-13. Now, historically, there was only one number over in the batch space. So if you see a batch number that's just like a 9 or something to that effect, definitely worth picking that up. That's quite a rare bottle these days. But recently, Belle Meade really ramped up production and started doing these dash numbers in the batch section. Now, I've heard on good authority that those low batch numbers are really wonderful. But these dash batch numbers are no slouch, so let's go ahead and give them a shot. Ooh, that's a nice deep one. Oh! It done fucked up. When you don't get a lot of information on a bottle, particularly when the bottle doesn't say distilled at and gives you a location, it always makes me question, did they make this themselves? Did they age it somewhere else? And again, there's nothing wrong with buying distillate from someone else. I would just much prefer they'd have some level of transparency. Even if you can't say where a whiskey's from specifically, because oftentimes distilleries don't want to tell people that they're letting others buy their juice to put into their own products. So even if you can't say, oh, this is from this distillery, putting the location where it's distilled can often be a giveaway. For example, whenever I see distilled in Lawrenceburg, Indiana, I know it's an MGP product. MGP is one of the biggest distillers in the world, and they're in Lawrenceburg, Indiana. So I see that location, I know that's where it's from. But the vast majority of their product is being sold to small distilleries and others who want to play around with the distillate and release it as their own product. So I don't know exactly where this Belle Meade product is coming from, but that doesn't matter that much to me if I enjoy it. I believe I bought this bottle for $55, maybe $60, but I know I've seen prices much higher than that, particularly because it's so hard to find in certain places. It's worth mentioning that the cask strength version of this is not as high as a lot of whiskeys I've reviewed on this channel. 58.3% alcohol. That is high, no doubt about it, but I've had things on here that were 60, 65, maybe even 70% alcohol. This is small potatoes compared to that. This is actually sort of in the butter zone for me in terms of drinking. I really like my whiskeys between 55 and 60%, I've found. So when I see something like this, I kind of jump at the opportunity. I'm getting like a chocolate chip cookie, which is a weird nose. It's not something I've ever given as a note, but it's because I'm getting a distinct chocolate note, there's definitely a sweetness, and there's definitely baking spices and vanilla, and you put all those elements together and it just feels like you're baking cookies. Maybe some honey in there as well. It's a really fantastic nose. I mean, this is wonderful. There's a hint of maybe lemon zest or something in there as well, but I can't get away from that chocolate note. There's like a chocolate chip, a semi-sweet chocolate, a honey sweet chocolate, and a sugary cookie dough. There's almost a creaminess on the nose in this as well. All these elements are really making me feel like I'm baking. It's a baking experience in a glass on the nose. It's making me more and more excited to taste it, to be honest with you. Some of the grains start to separate as I keep nosing it and waiting for things to change on the nose. That definitely will happen. Noses change as you let them sit. And as you stir them, you'll see me doing this a lot when I'm drinking whiskey, what I'm essentially doing is aerating the whiskey. When you add air to whiskey, it changes the flavors, it changes the notes, and it actually can slightly reduce the alcohol content. But mainly when I'm spinning it like this, you're releasing the ethanol in sort of a straight line through the middle of a Glencairn glass, and then you put your nose on the side, and your scent notes won't be predominantly alcohol. The alcohol has been sort of pulled through the center of the glass. You're gonna be pulling out the other notes from the other components that go into a whiskey that come out of the distillate, that come out of the barrel, and all the other elements that become flavor profile. Definitely worth reminding you as well to keep your mouth open if you're nosing a whiskey and you really wanna pull some fun notes out. Closing your mouth makes the alcohol stay in your nostrils and makes it a lot more difficult to pull other notes out. When you open your mouth, it gives the alcohol, the ethanol, a place to escape from, leaving you with a lot more of the flavor components. I think they're called esters. All right, I think I've kind of given you everything I can pull from this: the vanilla, the baking spice, the chocolate, the sweetness, the grains, the batter, the cookie batter. It's a fantastic nose, but let's give it a taste and see if the taste compares. Wow, very spicy. Coming out of the gate, it's a lot spicier than you expect. The nose is so gentle and sweet and kind of lulls you back. You forget that it's almost 60% alcohol. When you taste it, it reminds you it's almost 60% alcohol. The wood is very prominent in the palate, but it's not bitter like the wood tannins. It's a sweet wood. It's almost like you poured honey on oak, and that those are the kind of notes you're pulling from it. The middle on this whiskey, I'm getting some chocolate, which I was picking up on the nose, but it's pretty subtle. I'm actually getting some herbal notes in this, almost a mint, but it's not, it doesn't have that spiciness of mint, but there's definitely an herbal quality to it. It's sweet and herbal. The vanilla's prominent. There's a bitterness on the finish, but it's not a wood bitterness, it's an herb bitterness. There's my tongue tingles a little bit with the heat, but it's not too overwhelming. It's a really enjoyable pour. It keeps changing on me. When I first was drinking it, I got a lot of the woodiness. It became different spices. I got some of the herbal notes, and some of the sweetness is starting to come out. The honey is really prominent. I can definitely see why they would do a honey barrel release, because if this is the kind of distillate they tend to use, you put that in a honey barrel and the honey becomes very prominent. That's something that makes total sense to me. I hope I'd be able to try the honey barrel Belle Meade that's out there. But I know that right now it was such a rare release. I believe there were about 600 people, give or take, at the first release at the distillery in Tennessee. That's too many people for me to wait in line for. I'm sorry, I can't abide by that. The person who I know that got a bottle of the Belle Meade honey, they arrived at the distillery at 3 in the morning for, I believe, a 9 a.m. release. So, as I near the end of this pour, and I just smell the glass, which is a fun technique, by the way. Finish a whiskey, put it aside, come back, smell the glass, you'll get some different notes. I'm getting almost like a nuttiness. I'm gonna go ahead and do something here that I haven't done in a while, maybe ever on the channel. You're gonna go ahead and just take the glass, put your hand over it, turn it upside down, turn it back upside down. Now your hand's full of whiskey. Rub it. And you rub it until your hand is dry. What you're essentially doing is getting rid of all the alcohol and all of the water, and you'll get a little heat. Now, you smell it. The honey kind of falls by the wayside. You get a lot of grain, you get a lot of the barrel. It's a really fun way to get the essence of a whiskey and move the ethanol out of the way, especially with something that's barrel proof. You can see what kind of other notes you might be missing, but doing that, I get a lot of wonderful, sweet woodiness. The honey is gone, but there's still a sweetness to it. And on the final notes of the nose, the final part of this glass, the wood has become incredibly prominent. It's almost a charred oak. It's not smoky, but it's a charred oak. Oh, maybe cooked apples too. The baking spice is still prominent. It's very baking spice centric, and vanilla is very prominent as well. It's so interesting to me that the baking spices just aren't there very much on the palate. They show up a little bit, but they're so prominent on the nose, and the palate then becomes this woodiness with hints of fruit and a lot of honey and all this other stuff going on. The differences between the scent and the taste are really interesting. So I finished that glass, but I'm not done yet, so I'm going to add a little bit more. Two drops, not very much, but I don't have very much whiskey. Oh, it calmed it down a lot. Ooh, okay, so there's a peanut butter note now. And that's something I've gotten out of a lot of Beam products. Booker's most notably gives me this peanut butter character. But I wasn't getting it before, but it's like a honey peanut butter sweetness. Maybe like a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. It kind of moves away from the baking spices and more to a PB&J situation. With like strawberry jam, maybe? Oh, it's very good. I might actually like the nose better with some water added, which is very unusual for me. All right, let's see if the taste is living up to the smell. I bet it won't, because the taste was very different from the smell without water, so with water, I would expect the same thing. Yeah, it's good. Honey, apple. Then it evolves into that woodiness, that richness on the mid-palate. There's definitely more of a chocolate note. There's like a brown bread quality to it. Like a, not a rye bread, but like a pumpernickel or something. A rich, deep brown bread, or like a whole wheat bread. You spread some butter on it. Or like a honey biscuit, but it's a whole wheat honey biscuit. There's a lot of interesting things going on with it. But the wood is very dissipated. It is there. When you add water, the wood still exists, but it's much quieter. You get a lot more of this breadiness. The sweetness can kind of stand out. It's a really cool pour to add some water to, actually. I very often will add water just to see what happens, but I don't really care for the final product. But on this one, I actually like very much what happens when you put water with it. That might be something I do continually in the future with this pour, because I like the effect on the nose very much. You know, the Belle Meade cask strength is something I might actually add water to on a regular basis in the future. That's not a very common thing for me, but I really enjoyed how it changed with the water. Both ways are great. You know, the price on this can't be beat. If you can find this at 50, 60 bucks, absolutely pick it up. Very good whiskey. It's one of my personal favorites, honestly. If you agree with my palate, typically, you will really like this Belle Meade cask strength. And I know some people will watch this show that will not agree with my palate, and that's okay too. Find people you agree with or you find are interesting and take them at their word. I have friends who I know if they don't like it, I'll like it, and that's great. It means there's more whiskey for them on things I don't like, and more whiskey for me on things they don't like. So definitely recommend the Belle Meade cask strength. You all keep drinking like professionals. I'm gonna go get me some more of this. Cheers.